Today we had VBS, which is Vacation Bible School for those who are keeping score at home. And one of the great parts of VBS is that as a pastor, now that I'm officially a pastor, no longer a stupid administrator, not that I got smarter, I just hate the title, but it was awesome because there you are in front of like 160 kids, right? And I had them yelling so loud. They were so energized that when they were done, they probably were bouncing off the cars and going home like that. And as somebody said, you just cause chaos and then leave the kids with the parents. I'm like, yeah, that's a good job description for me. That's kind of what I do. And it is true, because if you look at it, St. Luke Parish, it couldn't be what it is without the incredible people who I've been able to team up with to make this parish to be what it is today. And what I mean by that is, like, we have four priests, Father Jack, Father Joe, and Father Mike, and really I feel like we're just a band of brothers. And it's really crazy to think that we just drive around for so long, all these different parishes, these churches, and it's amazing how each of them had my back as the administrator, and they would walk into things having no idea that, you know, we were doing this or this today, because maybe sometimes I forgot to tell them, and then boom, and they would just roll right with it. And so life happens, right? And then our dear deacons, the same thing. It's incredible that, you know, Deacon Jim Olson has just been, part of really helping our staff and our team come together with great cohesion, and him being a lawyer, keeping the focus, you know. And then, like, Deacon Tom Busick, we're so grateful. I mean, the fact that we can do two chapels with Eucharistic adoration, have over 500 people dedicated to 1 hour of adoration each week at the least, is incredible. So much so, like in the Valley where we started just a couple years ago, it was just Monday to Thursday. Well, now it's Monday through Friday. And the chapel there, which is built for about 10 people, they're saying it's too small now. I'm like, this is a good problem to have. Like, too many people adoring Jesus. Like, praise God for that, right? And then you look at our staff, and it's unbelievable. Like, we have 23 employees who just every day remind me of this gospel, of what it means to follow Jesus, of what it means is to get up and give up so much that they could be doing and making in order to follow Jesus. One of the most common traits of all of our staff is they could be making much more money, having much less headaches than dealing with me and anywhere else. And they've chosen to work here. And I realize that the main reason for that is because their boss is certainly not me, but it's Jesus Christ. And it's in this gospel passage that so beautiful to be able to open up the parish of St. Luke and to just think about that, right? Like, Jesus walks by the tax collector's booth, and my favorite painting, the painting that has marked my life more than any other painting, is this Caravaggio painting. And Caravaggio was a character who, let's face it, he was exiled from the church because of his violence. He was not a character that you would, you know, probably wander in and want to, like, be like tenderly praying with. He's very much a rambunctious character, but he understood something that I love about his paintings, and that is that the use of the light and the dark. Don't we all feel like that sometimes? Like, we're in these great moments of ecstasy, and boom, the agony hits. We're in these great moments of grace, and boom, we just feel the temptation. We're in these incredible moments of bliss, but at the same time, there's this darkness, and that proves that we're still on earth. And that was the thing about his paintings. And he used to get mad, people got mad at him, like bishops and people. You know why? He loved painting dirty feet. Yeah. Well, don't we all get dirty feet? Right? I mean, we all need to shower. And he wasn't afraid of showing Mary, who would be walking out in the middle of the dust, dirty. Or baby Jesus, dirty. Or fingernails that were dirty. And so anyway, this call of Caravaggio, the call of St. Matthew, is, and he has this dramatic scene of Jesus pointing like this, you know? And anybody who knows paintings, that great moment of touch of Adam and God the Father by Michelangelo, and Caravaggio just plugs right into that. And that's what it's like to work with a team of 23 employees who have felt this touch of Jesus, who have felt this finger of God guiding them to work with us. And so it creates such a vibrant life of working when you go into these different places and our offices and all the different things that are going on. It's just so inspiring to to see it all coming together. I mean, just like today, Faith Formation, I think we've had 250 kids come through VBS this summer, and whether it be Chris Patch in the Valley, or Emma and Jason up here, or Nick just taking, they just got back from mission trips. It took about 30 kids on mission trips to rebuild homes and to craft the hearts of those that they have in their hearts and the hearts of those there in Kentucky. And this is the first time that we've ever been able to do not just a fall retreat, but a spring retreat. And now we're gonna do this summer experience at Franciscan University to just really allow the high school kids to continue to grow in their great love for Jesus Christ. And you just see that. And then not to mention what's going on with like Young Life and Keenan and Baker and being able to work with these kids who most of them don't have parents. They go home at night and they have nobody to take care of. And so a lot of times they can get into trouble, and Keenan's offering these after school programs and places for kids to be able to know that their name and their heart matters, even though their parents could be in jail doing drugs and don't even love them. And when you see that, you realize how beautiful it is that the generosity of our parishioners to give us this place to work, this space, is so blessed. And you know, and you can see it through, you know, like even Scotty over there getting me set up for Mass. How many maintenance guys understand the difference between a chalice and a paten? You know what I mean? It's like, it's so cool to be able to get books set up, to be able to get adoration set up, and they just set me up to succeed. And just as today, I usually show up late, and they're like, he was wondering, will we have a priest? And so, again, whether it be Mark or the Yoakum brothers, Dan and Doug, it's incredible. And then in the Valley, we have Michael Deshane, who continues to just be able to work so hard to help our places and our facilities to be able to succeed in bringing people to Jesus Christ. The other day, we're cleaning out Good Samaritan, the rectory there. It's only 102 years old. So there's dust from the turn of the last century in there, right? And it smelled like that up there in some places. And I had this crazy idea, which you can actually see on a video, that the carpet that was up there was so dirty that if we brought it down the house, you know, you ever see Pigpen and like the Peanuts? Mm-hmm. That's what was gonna happen. It was just like dust was gonna be everywhere. So I had the great idea of just throwing it out the third floor window. And this carpet goes from here over to there. So it was a pretty big carpet. So we folded it up and so I had people down there making sure that the doors were not gonna come out and get hit on their head by like a carpet. And wouldn't you know, one, two, and then three, the carpet went out perfect, headlong, flipped down, and hit the landing like a 10. You know, perfect landing. And the dust just went everywhere, and everybody clapped for me. I'm like, that's your pastor for you, throwing carpet out the third floor window. And the maintenance guys are like, oh my gosh. But then, you know, there's also just like the pastoral care, which has so much to do with what both Karen and Cindy have been able to do, to be creative, to keep up with somebody like me who can be so impetuous, but at the same time to recognize that it's gonna be the care of the souls that God has entrusted to us. It's the key to being able to respond to the call of Christ. Like this component is so central. You can see it here in the gospel where Jesus talks about, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. If there's somebody who doesn't need a physician, that's not, it's like all of us realize that we do have these sicknesses, we do have these issues, we do have these challenges. And it's in that that we get to serve and realize the need for that. And it's so beautiful to look at the way in which, you know, even like Betsy and Claire who work up here, or Jan and Marilyn who work in the Beaver Valley, that the voice, the love, the tenderness in which they try to just welcome people into our parish. I had this one dear woman, she'd been away from the church for 25 years. And started to think that she wanted to come back to church. So she went to different places and she found our staff and our parish so welcoming that she decided to come here. And the other day when we did our final St. John and Paul Parish Mass, she's by herself because she just joined the parish, and she's thinking there's coffee and donuts afterwards. She's like, have you ever been to a place by yourself and you're like, do I really want to go to a social event not knowing anybody? And she goes, well, I like coffee, so I'll go get a cup of coffee. So she walks into to our parish hall here, and the first thing she sees is there's this video being played. And the video had a picture of her friend who died 15 years ago. And that was the last time she was in church. It was for her friend's funeral. And of all the pictures that could be up on that video, if you saw the video, it was about a 5-minute video, it happened to have her friend as she walked in and felt once again so welcome. And that's, again, it's amazing what's able to happen. And you know, when you think about all those who have passed, the amount of people that take such tender care of that. And obviously, part of that is like what Bridget and Hiri do with the music. And I think there's a sense, at least in my heart, when I was doing these last masses, of like, how many notes, how many words are sung, how many hymns are chanted, right? And you can almost imagine how God is just listening in, you know? They say in Gregorian chant, if you sing too loud and you can't hear the ones that are around you, you're not singing right. Well, in God's ears, all of our voices matter. All of our voices hit his heart with such harmony. And when the beauty and truth of sacred music, as Bridget and Hiri are able to transmit, it is so incredible to just be able to feel that and to like experience that. And I'm just so grateful because I know that in Jesus' heart, like the one time he sings is right when he starts the Eucharistic tradition of having the Eucharist at the Last Supper. And what a blessing it is to be able to do that. And obviously part of our care ministry is what Janet does. Janet's kind of like this freelancer. So she's involved in everything. But one of the things that she does do is just brings that caring heart of Jesus to those who are in need. And there's this Latino population, which is just, it's worse than what the news could possibly say about it. Little kids that have these tooth issues that are infecting them, that are on the brink. They've never learned how to brush their teeth. And so Janet and then this Anna are helping these little kids to get dental care. And then the way that they're sleeping and their food and just on and on, it's just beautiful to see how the Lord is blessing us through the pastoral care of so many. And you know, and then there's obviously the finances, which is kind of the area which I hate to talk about the most, but without it doesn't work. And dear Marilyn Schroeder, Eileen and Bobby are so good at helping us manage that. In fact, it's funny, right? Jesus is calling Matthew away from the money, but yet I was given the title of money. And it seems like every time I step anywhere, well, do you have enough money? And I've always been it's been very simple. The mission is first. Money will follow the mission. And to me, it's risk, do as much as we possibly can to bring Jesus Christ to the hearts of our people. And if we're authentically doing that, the Lord will bless us. And I rarely talk about money, but I'm so grateful for all those who have generously shared their money with our church, because I know that this church did not get built just because there were nice prayers going on. It took a lot. And same thing with with Good Samaritan. It's the same thing. And then finally, one of the most surprising areas that we have in our church is Lee and Angie. Those two are surprising. They're like a surprising group, because marketing and communications is not a typical area of a Catholic church. And what's so beautiful about what they can do is they can take people like me who love to do all these different things and do exploring Catholicism, or take the stories that you have in your hearts and transmit those into testimonies in our weekly bulletin. And it's amazing that we are able to, with all of our people, be able to transmit such a great gift, which is our Catholic faith, through the love and hearts of our employees. And so today, as we begin this St. Luke Parish, I realize that I just am a part of a team that is so blessed, so graced, so wonderful to work with. I often wonder because I have to bounce back and forth, right? That like, this is not like your normal working place where the boss has to be in for people to work, you know? In fact, people are so convinced and so like self-starter, hardworking, that sometimes I have to like slow down myself and those around us to keep pace with what the Spirit wants us to do. So today, let's be grateful for how Jesus Christ has called each of our employees to this heroic following of his son Jesus, the heroic following of Jesus, and know that all of us are inspired every day to just allow the finger of Christ to look at us with love and say, follow me.